canal-based surgeries. For over a year now, since I've left the United States and moved to Germany, I haven't had a conflict of interest. First, I want to talk about epibulbar versus canal-based surgeries, then about the technology and the techniques by providing some examples. I want to show you some results and compare different surgical modalities. I want to show you challenges that we face as surgeons and provide you a brief outlook. Epibulbar versus canal-based surgeries. Here you see all sorts of flying objects approaching the eye. On the left side, the epibulbar drainage devices. Here is an Ahmet glaucoma drainage device, a preserflow microshunt that is inserted ab externo under the conjunctiva into the anterior chamber, and the gel shunt, the Zen gel shunt that was meant to be implanted from the inside into the subconjunctival space or subtenon space, but turned out to have a high revision rate, close to 50% in year one in some studies. So I prefer to implant them ab externo, from the outside in, where you can control the bleb formation extremely well. And I'm happy to say that both with the preserflow microshunt and the Zen gel shunt, my trabeculectomies have become very, very predictable. And then the classical trabeculectomy, where you basically create an incision, a flow tract, more through the cornea, or sclerocornea, one should probably call it. It's not a true trabeculectomy in the sense that you don't typically excise the trabecular meshwork anymore. And that allows the fluid to drain into the subtenon space. On the right side, the gold shunt that is not in clinical use anymore, the CyPass that was equally inserted into the suprachoroidal space, a potential drainage space that was hoped to create low pressures, and these two devices were meant to regulate flow, but this space too is not privileged in any ways as was initially hoped. There is fibrosis, just as there is fibrosis on the outside, that has been the biggest problem with the trabeculectomies. And suprachoroidal drainage is not really such a new concept. The good old cyclodialysis spatula that we nowadays use more to manipulate things in the anterior chamber during anterior segment surgery is really meant to create an incision through the sclera and then detach the ciliary body over approximately 5 millimeters or so to each side to have basically a cyclodialysis. That works well, it lowers pressure well, but it can close in unexpected ways, and so patients can go from single digits to a pressure of 50, which is dangerous and painful. So all these on the right side currently have fallen out of favor. And the traditional epibulbar procedures, trabeculectomies and tube shunts, they do have very significant risks and complications. Flat chamber, leaking bleb, kissing choroidals from having too low of an eye pressure. You can see here these bullae and touching retina, although the fluid is under the choroid. An eroded tube shunt. Here too, you can see that there was a trabeculectomy here. This looks more like a primary. The primary tubes tend to do better. Tube shunts were originally meant only to resist the scar formation of patients who had failed trabeculectomies. And here you can see a tube that has aspirated vitreous apparently, and the chamber also looks awfully flat with some peripheral edema. Blebitis and endophthalmitis. As glaucoma surgeons, we live in denial, because why would you do a procedure that has an awfully high rate of that? 7% in this study. This is actually a study from the Mayo Clinic, so by no means is this in an environment where you would maybe think that infections could happen more readily. And that's a big number. Here you can see what happens if too much mitomycin is used. Scleral melting, where you can see the urea peek through. And this is contrasted by the very low risk of enhancing conventional outflow with Schlemm's canal implants, the Hydrus, for instance, a scaffold device inserted into Schlemm's canal much longer than the original iStent that you see here, a little snorkel that is punched through the meshwork and advanced a little bit. And then the iStent inject, the newer one, two are delivered in one injector, so you have a higher chance of actually hitting the right space, but also of hopefully getting more flow. Tiny device, we'll talk about it a little more in detail a couple of slides down the road. And here, trabecular ablation. Implant free, you can imagine that implants, no matter what material, will create some response. They're foreign bodies in the eye, and that space too is not immune privileged in the sense that a foreign body is being recognized and there will be a response to that. So this is not happening here. You can see here the so-called GAT, gonioscopy-assisted transluminal trabeculotomy, sorry, transcameral trabeculotomy, where a suture is threaded through Schlemm's canal. Hopefully it really is continuous and you can get it all the way around in a circular fashion. Similar challenges like canaloplasties, that doesn't always work. But you then tear through this proline suture in this case, or a catheter that can have a guide light, a little laser guide light. To make this easier, TRAP360 is the device that has a retractable thick proline suture with a little knob at the end that you tear through one side, creating a 180 degree trabeculotomy, and then you do the same to the other side. So that works well. Of course, devices always cost more than just a suture. This is the trabectome, the most mature method of removing the trabecular meshwork. It's drag-free and has a plasma ablation tip. And then there's the Trabex. That's the original dual blade, first invented by George Barholt, as is this trabectome here, in 2002. That never saw the market until recently, when it became clear that there is a relatively high demand for more simple devices. The trabectome requires a plasma, high-frequency generator, so there's an overhead investment, and many surgeons prefer having disposable devices that basically don't need another machine to be plugged in. The Cahook dual blade works very well, and the Trabex sort of builds on the on this market, although it is, as I said, an older device, but it has irrigation and aspiration, so the view and chamber maintenance is better. We'll talk about this a few slides down the road as well. How do these differ, these canal-based surgeries? Here's the little iStent inject, the iStent first generation, and then the Hydrus that is longer. This is to scale. If you get a single bore access to Schlemm's canal, you have typically you open up a drainage segment of about 60 degrees or 1 clock hour. That's so because there are septations in Schlemm's canal and areas of true discontinuity. Here, for instance, you can see this. This is a human eye looking into the camera, a living eye, and the sclera is subtracted away, revealing the aqueous outflow channels. Here, this is an endoscopic laser. With that, you basically create an about 30 micron hole in the trabecular meshwork by leaning this against. This exists both as an erbium version and a UV laser. It It's done mainly in Switzerland. And this is, of course, the trabectome, where you can ablate through a single incision up to 90 degrees to each side, creating about a 180 degree ablation if you're good at it, if you're experienced with it. That's not absolutely necessary to create such a long ablation, but why not if you can? You get about 30 degrees then on each side, 30 degrees in addition to or past the ablation ends, so you end up with about 240 degrees. Now compare this with a 360 degree procedure. You can imagine that there isn't that much missing, and in fact the nasal flow channels are the largest ones, where there is most outflow occurring anyways naturally, so the temporal ones might not matter too much. Looking at the complications and comparing them from an apinternal trabecular meshwork ablation that's perhaps as extensive as it gets, using the trabectome with a traditional aggressive surgery, the trabeculectomy or a tube shunt, there are very few complications with the apinternal trabeculectomy. We had two cycle dialyses in 1,127 patients. Four had malignant glaucoma, one a suprachoroidal hemorrhage, one an endophthalmitis. Hyphema has everybody to one extent or the other. That's expected because the Schlemm's canal is unroofed, and when the pressure is lower than the episcleral venous pressure right after surgery, there is flow back. Here, on the other hand, additional procedures necessary in trabeculectomies were 74%, and 27% of tube shunts have this. Imagine you were buying a car and a dealer were telling you, sir, your car might need, in 74% chance, you have to have a second procedure of some sort within the first weeks, months, or years. Early and late complications, trabeculectomies, sort of even close to 40%. Tubes do better, but early on, there's less hands-on management required, and as a result, fewer complications. This is not the primary, the newer TVT study. This is the original one, but it's real data, and it reflects the experience by extremely experienced and competent glaucoma surgeons. Enhancement of outflow by nasal ablation here in a pig eye shows you that there is also in the pig and a little bit earlier nasal flow. After ablating this eye, this pig eye is looking in the camera. We're using fluorescein here. You can see a circumferential flow, and the timeline here is the same. So note that this starts much sooner than here. This is supraphysiological flow, of course, might be different in a human eye with glaucoma. And you can compute the flow rate. This just shows you by the brightness and the size of the spots that both the speed and the peak fluorescence is higher after ablation. How is this different compared to an eye stent, for instance? Here is an eye stent. You see only a very focal outflow. As I told you, in humans, you get about 60 degrees. Same with the pig. This pig does not have a continuous Schlemm's canal. There are rather little segments that look like Schlemm's canals, and they're interconnected, so it behaves remarkably similar with regards to outflow. Trabectome has a larger ablation. There is flow past the ablation site. This is an early image just to show the crisp filling. You get more diffuse circumferential flow just a few seconds after this. Technology and techniques. This is again the oldest device, the tip that creates a plasma with two electrodes and has irrigation aspiration, and one does need a generator for this high frequency alternating current to get the pico lightning going at the tip. This was developed because George Barbat noticed early on that a dual blade has a disadvantage in that it can create drag. The iris has fibers that insert into the trabecular meshwork. This is not entirely drag-free. So, and especially in high myopes with fragile anterior segments, this can occasionally create tiny bit of a cyclodialysis in that there is a very, maybe half a millimeter or so, disinsertion, not just of the removal of the meshwork, but actually the whole insertion into the scleral spur drops and reveals a sliver of suprachoroidal space. That does not result in a profound pressure of zero like a full cyclodialysis graft, but this is a disadvantage of the of a dual blade stick, a hooked dual blade, or even blunt ablations, or tearing off the meshwork, as with the Tanito hook, for instance. This can happen as well. But the advantage is you can plug this device into any phaco machine, vitrector. You can also plug this in the trabectome pump. It has irrigation aspiration. Let's move on to the next slide. You can see here the tip inserted into the Schlemm's canal. It's very short bursts and low duty cycle. It's sort of almost like YAC in that you create a plasma that molecularizes the meshwork and you aspirate the gas, basically. This here is the dual blade. It's serrated, which allows for a more controlled initiation of the cut. That's a little different from the KDB, the hooked dual blade, that has a smooth blades. The blades are intentionally a little more dull because the advantage of that is, in the view of that company, that you're less prone to creating any injury. You sort of displace the trabecular meshwork more than you perhaps cut it. This is how the surgery looks like. Temporal incision, clear corner incision, inserting the trabectome, going in at an angle, pointing the tip up slightly to peek or poke into Schlemm's canal, then straightening it out. This is an eye with a lot of pigment in the angle, easier to see. This is now an eye that has almost no pigment, so you can see the risk of confusing this with a ciliary body band. Ciliary body band or wrong side ablation is one of the most common beginner errors and creates a high pressure, blood, and an unhappy surgeon and patient. You can go 90 degrees. I'm showing this. There's no need to lift the lens, and you go to the right and basically be done with it. The Trabex works sort of similar. You go along, creating a strip of meshwork. You turn this around. You try to cut it. Doesn't always work. You can actually leave this if you can't cut it, or you can use tweezers to retrieve it, but you don't have to remove that little string of meshwork. This eye here has actually an iridotomy. This had a angle closure before getting cataract surgery. And basically how the surgery looks like. This is the eye stent, first generation. These images are courtesy of Ike Ahmed. You can see a very experienced surgeon going in, sort of almost like the trabectome. You could confuse it perhaps if you haven't seen too many. And there it is, inserted. Well done, steady hands. This is done through viscoelastic. He likes to knock it a little to the left to confirm it's positioned well so it doesn't fall out. And the same then to the right. The curious thing is, in most parts of the world, you only got one eye stent in the package. In Canada, I believe, you had two in there. There's a left-handed and a right-handed version. And the right-handed insertion is a little more tricky. There was also always the concern, are you confusing it? It is not absolutely necessary to make it point to the right, but the insertion is easier, because the angle of attack is better. And then this is quite fascinating, I think. Tripin blue being injected at the end of the surgery, also cataract surgery, blue dye in, and you can see this now exit through the episcleral veins. Note that he inserted three eye stents, so you might wonder, why on earth, if the eye stent is such a powerful device, why would you need one, two, and a third one that's not shown in this video? Yeah, good question. Unfortunately, these implants are not that effective. They're tiny. They're also quite expensive, around 1,000 euros. But you do get better flow if you implant three. Of course, you could just ablate the meshwork, but everybody has different preferences. Note that the infusion is set very high here. This equals a pressure of around 92 millimeter mercury. So you see this flash out, and you would think, gee, this patient has glaucoma. Look how quickly this flows. This is like a highway. Yeah, no wonder the pressure is maybe nine times as high as it should be in this patient. This is okay during surgery. It's only done for a short time, so these eyes do tolerate it. And this is the eye stent inject. So you only make a forward movement. You poke into Schlemm's canal. One, two, there are two in one injector. And then you can see here as well, if you pay close attention, a little bit of reflux confirming this is implanted in the right space. Again, courtesy of Ike Ahmed. Thank you for sharing these movies. Results and comparisons. Well, the good news is you don't have to combine phaco with trabectome or any other ablation of the meshwork. They do deliver almost identical pressure results. That is probably so because so much meshwork is removed that there is no trabeculoplasty-like effect from the phaco that plays otherwise a big role when you combine a little stent or snorkel, the little eye stent, with phaco. There, the phaco has a noticeable effect relative to the eye stent, which doesn't have such a big effect. So you do get a compound effect. Here, you don't. You maximize the outflow right there, and the medication drop is about the same. Note that this is coarse and exact matching here as a strategy to compare. This allows for extremely similar patient pairs that some say rivals a randomized controlled trial in the evenness of data distribution. We have 5-year data. This is primarily the these are primarily the surgeries done by Joel Schumann. When I arrived at UPMC, I started to do them as well. But these are all patients that had 5 years of follow-up, sort of almost a not just a single center, but a single surgeon or maybe two surgeon. Dr. Ian Connor also had done these before I got to the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. And so you see, you get a pretty good drop. This is combined with phaco. So these patients don't start out with a super high pressure. They have a mixed indication, both a cataract surgery and a mild pressure reduction, but they're stable for 5 years. That's not bad. If you treat more severe glaucoma, you get a larger pressure drop compared to ocular hypertension. We created a glaucoma severity index. There are a bunch of fudge factors, or it's basically just sort of computed, taken into account medications, preoperative pressure, and the visual field severity to capture the severity of a glaucoma for a clinician. The more mets, the more challenging, the more severe the visual field, the more challenging, and the higher the pressure, the more urgent. But you do see the worst glaucomas get a bigger drop, so that's very nice. Looking at an electron microscopy after a trabectome ablation, this is courtesy of the late Doc Johnson from the Mayo Clinic, where I spent, where I did my PhD, spent 4.5 years. This shows you that that you really have to search for the collector openings. They're sort of hidden, and most of them are very anterior and posterior. And this could be the answer why in adults a goniotomy or just a trabeculotomy, a disruption, very much actually like we do now with the GAT or any blunt disruption, why these could close. If you have two lips, which you don't see here because they're ablated, but if you just cut through the center or disrupt this, the ends of the anterior and posterior meshwork can roll inward and potentially block those. So this could be an explanation why to this day goniotomy and trabeculotomy don't work quite as well as trabecular ablation with a trabectome, with a Cahook blade, with a Trabex. And that doesn't happen in kids because in children, children have such an elastic scleral spur. The pull from the ciliary body is so strong, it pulls us wide open. It's fascinating to see a goniotomy or trabeculotomy done in children. It behaves quite trabectomy results in narrow angles are very similar compared to open angles. You can see this here. Basically, that is surprising because these eyes had only a trabectome. They were phakic eyes, and there's no difference in pressure. They did not form synechiae that were devastating in very narrow angles, Schaffer grade less than 2. With phacotrabectum, you see the same thing. There's no difference. And there's no difference between phacotrabectum versus trabectum. So removing the lens apparently in these patients didn't make such a big difference. Somehow, this just stayed. You can do trabectum surgery after a failed trabeculectomy. The collectors don't atrophy to the point where you cannot resuscitate them. Pretty reasonable pressure drop here from 24. And here from a lower, because again, they have a mixed indication. Many of these patients have a reasonably well-controlled glaucoma. They just want to reduce medications. When comparing up internal trabeculectomy to OMET glaucoma drainage implants, here size to scale comparison, again, a matched strategy here, very similar patients. The pressure drop is the same. I wouldn't have expected this. I thought the OMET would give a much bigger pressure drop. More surprising, perhaps, is that the trabectomes need fewer medications compared to the OMET. Well, the OMET, of course, is a silicon device. It's a foreign body reaction. So it's a capsule forming around these implants. Therefore, you need more medications. If you compare trabex versus trabectome, one is the plasma ablation. The other one is the dual blade ablation. They, out to 30 days, it's very recent data, don't see a big difference. They seem to trend a little lower, maybe due to the sliver of ciliary body band injury. That's sort of intentional. And the question is this a disadvantage later on or not? We will see. My guess is it's not because this is no different from the Cahook plate, so the results will probably be more or less identical to the trabectome. Here, trabectome versus eye stent. Now, unfortunately, this graph does not have a significance indicated, but there is a difference starting at 6 months where the pressure trends upward with the eye stent while the trabectome stays low, and the eye stent patients need more drops than they did at the beginning. This is shocking, actually. I wouldn't have thought that. These are exact matched patients. So there's literally no difference in pressure and medications. And we see the same with the eye stent inject. There too, you have a worsening pressure at 6 months and an increasing of medications. That does not happen in the trabectome. Trabectome versus trabeculectomy. The trabeculectomy is still the king of low pressure. You can see this here. Compared to the up internal trabeculectomy. Interestingly though, if you include secondary surgeries as a failure or as a criteria for success, the trabeculectomies need so many early on that they degrade quickly. This does not happen with the trabectome. The success rate here in these exact matched patients was much higher in the trabectome. Of course, you could say, well, my patient doesn't need a pressure of 15, I need a pressure of 12. Yep, with that criteria, trabectome would not have had this nice success curve. But we borrowed it from the TVT study, and this is a common criteria for other minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. Challenges. Here you can see the eye stent and the hydrus. This one obviously has some fibrosis or maybe even foreign body reaction occur. This is the hydrus, and you can see how it compresses collector channels where I don't don't know whether it's a duplication of Schlemm's canal, but there is something being compressed. There's a biofilm that deposits inside these implants. And that could explain why at around 6 months, they don't work so well anymore in our hands. Implanting them is difficult. You can see here a patient who was referred to us with a question, why does this patient not have a good pressure control? One of the eye stents was sitting in the cornea, the other one in the ciliary body band. So not such an easy technique. It looked easy in Ike Almond's video, but they're not trivial procedures. First trainee cases, in the angle you can see here, two former fellows of mine, anxiety, tremor, awkward movements. You can see how eye stent maybe ends up going to the cornea or in the ciliary body band. It's already difficult to get into Schlemm's canal with a device that has active INA and provides you great view. So there is a steep learning curve. Don't underestimate this. In fact, there is a learning curve that is quantifiable. We've done this with many, many, many pig eyes. From early to late, the later in the learning curve, the better the ablation, indicated by a gray bar here. First eyes had no ablation in some, and then later on, as they became more proficient, we got better results. People get faster with the surgery. The ablation length increases, as I've just shown you. Maximum is achieved at around 10 eyes, and a relative operating score maximizes sooner. One needs about 5 eyes to become safe in the anterior chamber. It turns out, though, that one needs actually around 30 eyes to maximize flow as measured by fluorescein. You have a difference between active INA in the Trabex and the KDB through viscoelastic bubbles, a diminishing angle as you go to the right. This does not happen here because it's got an active INA, and so you see at the end of ablation deep anterior chamber and a pretty shallow anterior chamber in the right pass with the non-INA device. The good microscope is key. You can see here going into with a nice Zeiss Lumera, pristine xenon light, good color rendering index. You see lacy tissue. This looks nice. This is a different microscope. It can't even tilt very much. I'm doing the surgery here and I can't see a thing. The patient lies on his shoulder. He has a very sore shoulder. He can't lay still. There are movements. It's just awful. Also, this is a halogen light, so this adds to the whole misery that you get a poor color rendering and you can't see lacy tissue. There's a good chance to confuse the meshwork with the ciliary body band. This is an example now of a very experienced anterior segment surgeon, 20,000 cataracts under his belt. He sent me the video and said he doesn't get pressure reduction in his patients and he doesn't know what he's doing wrong. Sent me this video and kindly allowed me to use it. There's an eye stent, by the way, here. But he's going underneath the eye stent, so he's actually creating a cyclodialysis. This is a ciliary body band, and he's sticking in repeatedly. The eye is not tilted away enough. He doesn't see. You gotta see what you're doing, obviously, but that's easier said than done. And then he turns this around and ablates or enlarges the cyclodialysis going to the other side. This just shows you that even as a very experienced surgeon, you've got to take this serious, go back to the bench and learn, be a humble learner, and you became a very good trabectome surgeon. So removing the meshwork, we would expect really the pressure in the anterior chamber to drop to 8. Why is this not happening? Where is the resistance here? Look at this nice trabectome ablation. We can show in an animal model that the pressure does drop to a lower extent after the meshwork is removed, so there must be some resistor element that we haven't identified yet. And we know that we can dilate those with Netarsodil, for instance, a Rho kinase inhibitor. We get an additional pressure drop, a continued dilation. Maybe we should use this after Ablation surgery. Maybe there's additional millimeter mercury that we can squeeze out of these eyes and make it more effective. With nitric oxide, it works too. Of course, there are also nitric oxide or nitric oxide donors that are connected to a prostaglandin analog nowadays. So that would be maybe a choice. In summary, we talked about epibulbar versus canal-based surgeries. We said the canal-based surgeries are a lot safer. In some studies, factor of 10 to 20, fewer complications. Technology and techniques, up-and-turner trabeculectomy talked about, the most comprehensive ablation you can achieve. We talked about bypass stents. There is also something in between, that's the disruption of the meshwork. Results in comparison, the IOP after trabectome or up-and-turner trabeculectomy is not affected by cataract surgery. It is surprisingly similar to tube shunts. It's better than stents, but worse than trabeculectomies. And we took an outlook and we talked about the mysterious distal ulcer resistance. None of this would have been possible without the many good people in my lab and the outstanding collaborators, both nationally and internationally. Of course, perhaps even more important than having great people to work with you is being able to pay these great people, and for that you need institutions and agencies who provide you with funding. Thank you.